first set of notes. Okay.
Marty's got notes.
I've got notes. You should be scared if I have notes.
Here we go. This is Ham Radio Now, episode, 308? Bull session number 7, I think. I went back through the bull session list, which the last one I did was a long time ago, and I think that was number 6. So this is bull session number 7, I think. Look at this astute panel I've got.
Hey.
Everybody, hi. Everybody waves.
I know. It's impressive. Everybody's all this internet stuff is working well to have us all here.
Somebody
you didn't
said,
have to restart Skype too many times.
Yeah, I think it was
only once.
Somebody said that this is like Hollywood Squares.
Yeah.
It was Ward Square.
Yeah, Ward Silver.
You need more sound effects.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll work on that. So the episode is That Survey.
That one survey.
Survey says?
Well, there we go. That's another wrong show.
That's the different show.
All right.
So I think none of you guys are qualified to host that one. Sorry.
So the survey that we're talking about, now this reminds me that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So you go here to the website, you drop down to the bottom of any page. There you'll find Arvin. Yep. Click the pig. Your options for sending me money are monthly through Patreon, and I put that at the top, so I guess that must be my preferred to, every month. $1, that will be fine. Credit card one time, PayPal one time. You could mail me a check. My address is there somewhere. And don't ask me what happened to the DVDs. And so this is the thing that we are going to talk about, this ARRL entry level license survey. And I guess the point of this show is we're going to tell everybody what we think, and the ARRL is going to say, if those guys want that, that's what we're going to do. So the rest of you don't even bother with the survey.
Wow. We are the determining panel.
So Sterling may be on short time. We're going to try to get him to be able to get his comments early. But what I thought we would do is sort of pre-qualify ourselves. And I'm going to do this in what I assume to be order of having been licensed. And I think that puts me first. So I'm 1965 and I got a novice WN9NSO at the very beginning of 1965. And I upgraded from novice to general in about 4 months. By April, I had upgraded to general. And then advanced in a few years and in the year 2000 up to extra. So that is my experience. I've taught classes once in a while, and that's my qualification for thinking about the entry level license. Neal, I think you are number 2 on the hit parade.
I think I am. Does that mean I'm old?
Well, I'm 67. How old are you?
I'm 46.
Oh, you're a punk kid.
Yeah, I'm just a punk kid.
But you're WB9, so...
WB9.
So you were... So I'm going to guess 72?
76.
Okay.
1976 in July. So this July will be 41 years. WN9VPG first. And then when they decided to do away with those in calls, that was about the time I got my technician. So I was going to get one anyway. But I got my technician in 77, general in 78, and advanced in 79, and then waited until I was 18 to be an extra.
Oh, that's right. You were one of those prodigy 5-year-olds.
Yeah, 5-year-old.
Yeah, 5, 6, 7, and 9 for novice, tech, general, and advanced. And then I didn't want to do 20 words a minute code, so I waited until the VE program came along, and then I decided, I guess it's time to do this. So
yeah,
I was 18 when I got my extra.
Yep, I never even did the 20 word a minute code. I just I got a 5-word a minute extra, but a 13-word a minute advanced. So okay,
yeah. And I've taught high school chemistry for some years. And let's see, 23 years, something like that. And most of that taught ham radio after school in clubs, which is what I do now. And I was the 2004 ARRL Professional Educator of the Year.
Ooh.
That award, your claim to fame?
That award is no longer given.
And you have brought in lots and lots of brand new hams. Probably more than almost anybody else. And you are also the host of your own show. This is a this is a pundit heavy show. This is your show, Ham Talk Live.
Yes.
And it is on, it is actually live. We're live tonight on Facebook.
Facebook.
But you're always live, and here's your website. Well, it's actually stuck on Spreaker.
Actually, we did do a pre-recorded show last week because I had to work.
So you won't be live this week. You will be live this week.
We will be live. Yes. Thursday, we will be live with Michael Coulter from the Dayton Hamvention. So,
okay. That'd be a good update.
Yeah.
I'm not sure who it would be next, Sterling or David.
Yep. Well, let's see.
Yeah. Because David, what year were you licensed?
I was licensed in 2012.
Okay, no, Sterling is next.
Yeah, I was licensed in 2007. Kilo Delta Zero Bravo Zulu Echo, which was probably the worst phonetics I could have imagined. BZE. It was all right in CW, but I ended up getting my general class in 2008, extra class in 2010-ish or so, and I've got the call sign in Zero SSC for my initials, which has a much better... pronounceability and a much better ring on CW. My claim to fame, I'm nowhere at these other guys' level, especially Neil, with all those famous last call rewards. But I used to be the youth editor for the ARRL, and I was a recent college graduate of the W0EEE Ham Radio Club at Missouri S&T. So I've kind of been off and on again, kind of a youth perspective on the hobby. I'm real big onto social media. I actually participated in Youngsters on the Air in Europe in our age one to see how they do ham radio and try to bring some of their skills, their ideas into the U.S. And so, like, I'm in the middle of a big project to try to start a kind of a ham radio camp in the U.S. similar to Yoda. So that's what I do. I'm really interested on this whole like license thing because we used to have novice class, then they got rid of it. But then we look at other countries, like they have foundation licenses, there's still merit in it. So
yeah, it's not opinion time yet. That's coming up.
Go ahead, David.
Yeah. But first, you never had a novice.
No.
You came in after the novice era. I don't know what y'all
are talking about. And I'm also a no code extra. Well, I know a little bit of code. So I know little code extra.
You know the other code.
Yeah.
Computer code.
Exactly. Well, a little bit of that too. I wish I would do more of that. But yeah, I came home after the novice, after the advance, after they got rid of the CW requirement. I didn't even know there was a CW requirement when I was first getting into the hobby. After the fact, I heard people talking about, "Oh, did you learn CW? Did you do the 5 words per minute?" I'm like, "What?" So I had to look it up and go, "Well, that was a thing." So totally missed out. And I don't know if that would have limited me, because I feel like when I was in junior year of high school, I was studying the extra. I was doing phasers and schematic diagrams and learning about like how circuits work, how digital systems, how the ionosphere works, all while doing trigonometry and early calculus and art and literature arts, all that stuff at the same time. So really, you're like early in, or I guess late in my high school career, but earlier in my life, when you would think most of us are doing stuff like football, dating girls, you know, participating in the typical teenage drama, but not me.
I didn't do football, girls, or trigonometry. I totally wasted my time.
Look you down.
So David, that makes you the punk kid of ham radio here.
Well, then Marty should have gone first. Or next.
Oh, well, now
now Marty would be the last one. So anyway,
that's true.
Yeah, that's true. So, I was licensed early in 2012. My original call sign was Kilo Juliet 6 Mike Charlie Quebec, and upgraded to General about a year later. Got my vanity call a couple years after that. Mostly MCOM, I'm a volunteer with Aries and EC in the LAX area. And no code. Well, actually, that's not true. About 6 or 7 letters so far. We're still working on the rest of it and studying for general.
All right. But you are somewhat involved in getting young people into ham radio, but mostly you're here because you're the co-host of the show.
Yeah.
And he's the adult of the
show. I will be the adult. I will be the second oldest in the room and the adult of the show. Yeah, a lot of amateur radio with Boy Scouts as well.
Yeah. Skype is doing its best to make this a radio show. You guys are frozen more than you're moving, but
That's Skype.
Yeah, we'll just enjoy the freeze frames. I'll be moving constantly. So, Marty, it's down to you, the punk kid of the group.
I guess if he was the punk kid, I don't know what it makes me, but I am Marty, KC1CWF. I guess I've been licensed, it'll be 3 years in November. So I'm not all that experienced in this hobby, but I've certainly done a lot. KC1CWF had the call the whole time. Everybody tells me to get a new one. I will never, or not for now at least. technician in November, I guess it was 14. February 15, I went for my, general, and then February 17. So this month or last month, depending on what time zone you're in, I got my extra. So I was kind of a slow poke, going for extra.
Well, David still hasn't, so.
I'm getting there.
He's working on it.
I believe in you, Dave.
I will get there. I'm getting to the old point where it's hard to remember stuff, so I'm hoping to get there.
Yeah, you got the hard test, too. When I took the extra, I had done my advanced long before when I could still learn things, and then they poured all that math into the extra test from the advanced and made it hard. I don't want to take that over again.
That's a good segue into what we're talking about
today. Yeah. So,
absolutely.
Oh, I was going to promote the show that you guys do.
We do a show.
Do a show. We actually, you do a show and you're going to do a show. So the Phasing Line is the podcast that you normally do. You regularly do.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And, I haven't heard number 7. I've heard number 6, but I haven't listened to number 7. So that's in my podcatcher.
You're missing out.
Yeah,
there's a special giveaway on that one.
Oh,
yeah, free money, and I make a lot of really weird sounds, which are worth listening to.
Yeah, I had fun with the end of that one.
Yeah, and there's bloopers. And then I guess we're both kind of panelists on an idea that could turn into a podcast. Hopefully, maybe eventually.
Would that be this?
That's this, which is the Noisy Key.
Yeah,
this is really a good
KC1CWF.
This is Jacob Keo, KD0NVX.
And I'm Sterling, N0SSC.
And I'm Chris, KD8YVJ.
And this is the Noisy Key Podcast.
This is an amateur radio podcast. We've started to bring...
So, Sterling, you explained to me what the concept of Noisy Key was, because that didn't make sense to me initially.
Oh, yeah. So, the idea of Noisy Key comes from the idea of... the opposite of a silent key, and it kind of is a little bit morbid, but bear with me.
Hey, I'm the silent guy. I'm the guy that did a show titled "Before You Die."
So exactly.
We can handle that.
So I think Jacob had the idea about. Well, I guess we all came up with it together. I don't know who actually came up with it, but the idea is There you go. A silent key is a ham who has ended their watch. As a ham who is no longer transmitting, and in other words, a ham who's not active. Like even
a silent key is a ham who is dead.
Dead.
Yeah.
There's the morbid part. But what's also a ham that is has let his or her license lapse? You know, 10 years goes by.
A lapsed ham.
A lapsed ham.
Yeah.
Well, I guess the idea came from that in the sense that a noisy key is the opposite. A noisy key is someone who's super active, super young. who's super new into it. So the exact polar opposite of, of a silent key.
I think it's a good concept. It didn't, and when I think of noisy, I think of signals that's weak or something that's, you know, static and, you know, making
a bunch of oxidation on a brass key.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. But I got it pretty quick after you started explaining it to me.
Yeah.
But yeah, the silent key is a ham who's dead. There's a name for a ham whose license has lapsed. He's a shortwave listener.
True. There you go.
All right. So
we thought it was good.
ARRL has got this survey going. Now it's been, I don't know, how long has it been since the novice license went away?
It went out in, so the novice test was changed for the first time, I guess, 1970, I want to say six. And that's not when it was eliminated. That was when its form changed. To a longer, more
from
complex
a 1 year, yeah, from a 1 year non-renewable to a 2 year renewable.
Renewable.
Well, two year non-renewable and then renewable, because there's still a handful of novices.
There's still novices who are kind of left in that period when the novice license was evaporated.
Yeah, and then they got rid of. Evidently, we don't get rid of licenses anymore because the novice is still around. The advanced is still around. But you can't get a new one.
Right. There's been petitions to merge them. So novices become techs and advanced become extras.
Yeah.
But and they get shot down.
They get shot down because hams are old fuds.
I took all the questions for the test and I passed it. And I'm hell of all. Anybody going to let anybody do it without taking the same test I did?
If you look back at the old advanced
And I drew tests. Cold pit oscillators, too.
Yeah, I did that.
If you look at the old advanced test, that actually got put into the extra test.
Yeah.
If I have this correct.
Yeah.
And the hard math was in the advanced
test. It was, yeah.
Yeah. The advanced, a lot of people thought was harder than the extra at the time.
Yeah.
You had to get that 20 words a minute on top of it to get extra.
And wasn't there also a period where the tech and the general written exams were the same? It was just the code speed that differed?
It was literally the same.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you passed the tech, the written test, and the 5 words a minute, and then eventually passed 13 words a minute, you got the general without taking the written test again.
General and tech had both the element 3. I don't know what element 2 or 1 was. I guess element 2 was the novice or tech.
Element
well, this
one.
Was back in, but in the 50s when they had the novice.
I don't remember. I don't remember, and I don't care.
Element one is what makes up the MROP exam for the Marine Radio Operator's Permit.
Oh, that's right.
And you need element one and element seven and element 3.
Marty, if you start explaining contest rules to us again.
Everybody's already gone to research.
Yeah, element one was the Morse code.
Well, now element one is MROP.
Yeah, the commercial has their own element one.
But they
element one was hydrogen.
Yes.
He's the chem teacher.
I got it.
Yes.
All right. So it's been a long time since there was a novice. The technician became the de facto entry-level license. Mm-hmm. And as Sterling, as you were trying to do the show on email with me a day or so ago, you're saying that you were wondering, well, first of all, you're blowing my show plan out of the water because I was going to go through the questions question by question and get the survey question by question and get people's responses. Mm-hmm. But if we do that, we're going to lose some content from you. So I think you are the one wondering, do we even need to do an easier test, a more entry-level test? Do we need more hams? Aren't we doing fine?
Well, I think in the email I posed kind of both sides of the picture just to demonstrate that this has kind of a massive debate potential, because you have your old curmudgeons who are like, no changes, it is as it is, anything that has an introductory license is going to dumb down the hobby, and that's like going to be the biggest opposition to it, is the fear of dumbing down the hobby. But also conversely, on the other hand, I think the argument against it is that there are tons and tons of new licenses coming into the hobby. So what, like, I mean, just in the past year, it's been growing. I guess the growth has been almost linear. Like, there hasn't been any huge jump or any huge decrease. It's just been, like, straight up linear for the last couple of years. And now we're into, like, the 730,000 of licensees. And they're all, you know, coming in as techs. I don't know exactly how those incoming techs fold off into becoming a general or an extra, but I think that's the argument against it. But I really want to promote the argument for it, for bringing back a novice or foundation license. And we'll talk about the international licenses. What they most other countries call it, the foundation license,
right?
as an introduction, to better meet the needs and the wants and the desires of hobbyists who need radio in their life but don't need ham radio in their life, if that makes any sense. Don't need, like, you know, rag chewing and contesting. They're more in for it for hacking and remote control, for using ham radio in their own hobbies. Like, airsoft is a big thing that has brought in a lot of some hams and a lot of also illegal operators using Beofeng ham radios, airsoft being one of them. And then
what is airsoft?
Airsoft, you know what paintball is?
It's like paintball.
Oh, paintball. Yeah. Okay.
Except plastic. It's with little tiny plastic
little pellets. Yeah.
And so yeah. There's
people
a big
use the Beofeng.
And what's the radio connection?
They're team sports.
They need comms.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so
FRS doesn't do the job for them.
It does. Well, I feel like it does do the job, to be honest, but sometimes these things can get really spread out. And so some people will bring in higher powered ham radios or MERS or GMRS radios with the stipulation they require a license, but not everybody there knows that there's a license that's required. So there might be some opportunity to get them licensed into ham radio and to show them a few of the things to keep them legal at the same time, but maybe only for a certain duration. This is kind of like the comments I put into the survey, is where perhaps the novice or the new novice or the foundation, I don't know, what should we call it, the foundation or the novice or the tech minus?
Well, there's a big difference between kind of what the British look at as the foundation and what is the and what was the novice. Do you have questions to ask, or can I
say? No, go ahead.
Okay. So one of the key things, I think, just to give, this is now giving my view kind of the whole thing, kind of the first part of the reasoning that was attached to the top of the survey that went out from the ARRL, talked a lot about attracting hams under age 30. And maybe I'm reading it here, but Gary can probably pull it up on the screen. And they're concerned about...
should be up on your screen.
Yeah, okay. They're concerned about the declining of populations of hams under 30 and the decline of number of people who get on the air. And those are two really key things to me. And the first thing is, we talk about how many hams there are, how ham radio is on an all-time rise, how there's more licenses than ever. Licenses, to my mind, are meaningless. A license is a piece of paper.
True. A person can have a license and not use it, and so this is where we have our, you know, inactive hams.
Right. And I think more than ever, we're attracting hams who are preppers, which is great. MCOM, people who like hiking, being in the wilderness, things like that. And while those are, MCOM is great, for example, but a lot of times, even though we have a lot of people who are preppers, for example, licensed, they don't always come out of the woodwork. And especially... we see this a lot more on HF. Although licensing is high, the amount of people who get on HF ham radio, the shortwave bands, I think is lower than ever. And what I'm
I think you could say the same thing about repeaters and almost any activity.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been complaining for over a decade that there's not much activity on repeaters. So, yeah, that's what I was going to respond
solutions.
To Sterling's comment about, you know, are there enough? It's... not enough to fill up the airwaves, not enough to fill up the repeaters, and David, not nearly enough to fill up the ranks of MCOM volunteers.
For some, for, for some reason, Ham seemed to think the solution to not having enough activity on repeaters is to build more repeaters. And yeah. I still haven't figured out why people think that.
Well, I don't think anyone said that. It's just true. Everybody wanted to have their own repeater. And when we went from four or five in a town that were very busy to 40 or 50 in a town and not very many more people to fill them, things spread out. Well,
So Marty, in Boston, can you get a repeater pair? Because in Los Angeles, you can't.
So the deal is, do you want to go through the coordinator? And you don't have to. The reason people do is they want to be like listed in the ARRL call book, which requires that you're coordinated. Sure.
You have some protection from interference if you're coordinated.
Yes.
Which did require to be in the repeater directory. That has changed this year.
And
that's a whole nother show.
That's a huge political thing.
That's a huge
problem. We'll do that one in Google Hangouts.
The politics of repeater coordination is such a big topic. Yes. But
I mean, point, Marty, was in Los Angeles, unless I want to go 220, I can't get a 70 centimeter or a 2 meter repeater pair because they're gone. It's not there.
And the answer is no, you really can't in Boston. And from my involvement, but at the same time, 90% of those repeaters are keyed up, kerchunked daily, and talked on weekly.
The same thing here. Right. And there's same some of them that are in more Indiana, active.
You can't get on 2 meters. In fact, you can barely get on 440. There just aren't any pairs. There's too many repeaters out there, and if you keep minimal spacing, and we keep short spacing and short spacing and short spacing, and there's just there's so many of them that there are no pairs here in the Midwest either. Yeah.
But the point about that is they're plenty of repeaters, not enough people using them.
They're not active.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But why do we need to keep making more repeaters?
Well, because people want to do that. It's the thing that people like to do.
I mean, it's fun.
But just about any repeater owner would probably be happy to have newly licensed people come use the repeater.
Absolutely.
Some of them. Sure.
Yeah.
I know in my local town, in my local area, we have one repeater which was made by a youth ham radio club, which is supposedly for youth, and kids seem to congregate on it. And I think that's kind of cutesy. I mean, obviously, you can't tell adults get off, but that seems to be where the kids hang out.
Yep. So, ham radio now, bull session number 8 will be repeaters.
Yes.
And now,
I wanted to throw in something. So, you know, Sterling talked about like the curmudgeons and what they'd want and whatever. And actually, I think it goes a little further. I actually think if you talk to, like in the groups that I go to and the clubs that I see or whatever, if you ask their curmudgeons, they actually want it changed. And they want to go back to the old days where you need to know code. And they don't want to leave it alone. They want to go to the far extreme. Right. And that would leave me out because, honestly, I wouldn't go that route. I wouldn't. Mm-hmm. I mean, I might go and learn the code, but I think a lot of people won't, right? You know, I live in a house with 7 people, and we're up to five amateur radio licensees. But I don't think other than me, anybody would learn the code.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's a lot of work.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's suggesting that it's that's going to be something we're going to do.
I think Gary, if you put out the vote to like the masses, and I don't know what the masses would be, I think there's probably enough of those old, long-time hams. A lot of them would say, if you're asking me what we should change, we should put the code back in.
A lot of people say we should really use the code as a way to weed out the lids, or non-ham radio lingo, the idiots, the jammers, the lowlifes.
Yeah,
but I'm not convinced we have an issue.
Well, and not a big issue. And Riley said that his biggest problem were extras.
Yes.
Old line, 20-word a minute extras. So
those are our problems in L.A.
Yeah.
I remember my Elmer absolutely refused to get his extra because those were privileges that were taken away from him when incentive licensing came along. So when they instituted 5 classes of licenses, that meant that you lost privileges. And you had to earn them back again. And you know, for his whole life, he would not do that. And there were so many people that were upset about the incentives being, you know, instituted. And, you know, there was the thing with conditional licenses, which they got converted to general, which would, everybody called it the mail order general because you took it by mail instead of in front of an examiner from the FCC. And people were like, oh, they're just not real generals. They're, you know, they have conditional license.
The conditional license was an early version of the VE system that is
phenomenally successful
today.
Yeah. What is it? If you live more than 150 miles away from an FCC.
From an office where they gave a test less than twice a year.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, in those days, a lot of country that was the case. Now, the VE program is just an extension of the conditional license.
And I would argue the VE program is one of the biggest successes in modern amateur radio.
I have to look carefully to see which cat this is. This is Sarah D.
Okay. Hi, Sarah D.
Yeah. Sarah D and Peanut. It looks so similar. I can't tell
the
difference.
Are these ones blind or can these ones
see? These are both blind. Where are you going, Sarah?
Well, so the teacher in the room here, Marty hit on what the teacher in the room was going to say, which is before we even get into all of this, what's our goal? What are we trying to filter out the lids? Are we trying to keep people out of ham radio? Are we trying to get people into ham radio? Are we trying to get experienced people who know all the electronics and know all of that stuff? Or do we want people who know how to operate a radio? And I'm not so sure that a lot of the questions that we should be asking are, do we need to make the test easier? I would argue we need to make the test more relevant.
I'd agree.
I put a proposal together a long time ago, and the question pool committee had made some changes and looked like they were going in a better direction, and they have. So I kind of dropped it, but the test has changed over the years. When Gary and I got into this, we had a study book. We had to learn all the theory. We didn't know what the questions were going to be. And then this guy by the name of Dick Bash came out and started collecting by mail all these people who would go take the test and said, hey, write down as many questions as you can, and we're going to try to sell this book that has all the questions in it. And that's when the FCC said, okay, you know, they fought it and fought it and fought it, and finally they gave up and they started publishing question pools. And so now, just like in education, we're teaching to the test. That we're not teaching a curriculum, we're teaching the test. And so the test becomes the curriculum. The test becomes what people are learning. And so we have to write the test questions to make sure that people are learning what they need to learn to be a successful ham radio operator. So I think before we get into all the licensing stuff, we need to figure out, okay, what is our goal with the license? Is it to educate people so that they use the radio properly, or is it to weed out the lids?
I mean,
go ahead, Marty.
You can go. I've talked.
I think sadly it's on topic, but I think it's like a bigger topic for the state of education in our country. It's really what we're teaching. What my kids are learning is to learn for the test, and it drives me up the wall.
Yeah.
Right. We should be learning things to learn things because they're important and interesting and relevant to the world, and not so that nobody gets left behind or whatever other, you know, lame acronym you can use for education.
Yeah. Go ahead, Marty.
I mean, I am experiencing this real time. I'm a student. I'm in the ninth grade. And one of the things I see, Neal probably knows this firsthand. Do you teach an AP course?
Yep.
What is the goal of an AP course? To get
pass
the kids
the AP
to pass
test.
Precisely. Yep. and I look at the things like the tech in the day ham radio courses where a guy will go through and he'll tell you all the questions and he'll tell you the answers. You don't need to know why there's the answer that it is. You don't need to know anything about ham radio. You just need to know the answers. So what does that set us up to do? That sets us up to get licensed. It sets us up to get a call sign, and it sets us up to know nothing. Because knowing that a telecommand is a one-way transmission that can terminate or start a station or whatever, or whatever the question is on the FCC test, is not going to tell somebody how to get on a 2-meter repeater and talk to people. It just won't.
Mm-hmm. So this is a problem, Marty. Is it that the tests and the questions are lame? Or because from my perspective, having someone go through that process and study the questions, whether they understand it or not, gets them set up so that I can work with them in my club or my area's organization, and they have the license so that I can teach them all the things they need to do to be a good operator. If they don't pass, you know, if they don't jump through that hoop, then I can't put a radio in front of them and have them push the pickle, right? Because they haven't done that. Now, I don't disagree that there are questions like the telecommand question that you called out that may or may not belong there. But from my perspective, it's just enough to weed out some folks, but it's also enough so that I can get people in so that I can work with them and teach them the things that they need to know so that they can be good operators.
Now, sure. Here's the one that got me, that got my attention. As I was talking to an fellow educator that I respect a lot, and we got into this conversation, and the question's gone now, but there used to be a question: what ITU region is Guam in? Yeah, 1, 2, 3, or 4. Okay. That question is not addressing what we need to address. Yep. We need to address, if you're in Guam, you are in a different ITU region, and therefore your band allocations are different. It's not memorizing that IT, you know, Guam is in ITU region, I don't even remember what it was, 3.
Yeah.
I mean, so if we're teaching to the test, which is the reality at this point, and you know, openly I admit in AP chemistry, I try to do both. I want to teach the chemistry and I want them to pass the test. But if you teach the chemistry, you won't pass the test because you don't know how the test questions are written.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to practice with the test so that you can understand how the questions are written.
Yeah.
So we have the same issue in ham radio. We've got all these questions like what region is Guam in, when it should be, whose call sign should you give first and whose call sign should you give last?
Right. I mean, can I say something here?
Oh, yeah, yours, Marty.
I have. Sure. So, I mean, I guess this kind of brings up the what I view as the most practical license that we see in amateur radio right these days, which arguably is the foundation license, as it's called in the UK. I know Sterling talked about it briefly.
Yeah.
But I have the question pool put up here, pulled up on my screen. And the although foundation. There's a lot
foundation license yeah. pool. Okay.
Yes. And although there's a lot of questions that could mirror the technician exam, I think there's significantly more useful things to know. There's questions such as, when do you give your call sign? Do you give his call sign first and then your call sign? Do you give your call sign first and his call sign?
Is that what I just mentioned?
Yeah, I think it was.
Go, Marty.
There's questions like, you are talking to M3ABC by amateur radio and friends are in his room. You may also talk to them. This is third party rules, for example. Not as relevant, but it's set up in a conversational nature. The questions aren't written as if they come out in a way that they're giving you real world circumstances. What are you going to really need to know to get on the air? Some other ones that I see. It's a shorter exam. You only need, I believe it's 26 questions.
Yeah, in Australia it's 25, and it's the same sort of idea. Much simplified questions.
And it's practical, right?
They're much more practical.
And I'd love that. I think that would be great because I get more of the people that I send that I think would be interested in amateur radio. I get more of them that would actually sit down for one test and get their license. And then again, you can bring them along and teach them the things they need to teach. That's what the ARRL should be working towards.
Again, is my point, is we need to decide, are we trying to filter out lids, or are we trying to keep it an exclusive club, or are we trying to make sure people know what they need to know to get on the air? And I don't care if it's easier or harder. I think it needs to be relevant. And I think if we make it relevant, then it may not necessarily need to be easier. I think it just needs to be relevant. And so maybe this is a way to accomplish that. I don't know what the intentions are with all of this, but I think if we make it more relevant and we're questioning the things that need to be questioned, then I think we're getting to where the test serves a better purpose. And like it or not, we're in this age of teaching to the test. And there's always going to be, and my students do it too, those people who go through and take the practice tests over and over again until they memorize enough to get a 75% and they're in. And so we're going to have to, if that's the world we're living in, then we're going to have to design a test that will teach them what they need to know and leave it at that. And then as we go up in class, then maybe we start adding some of that stuff in.
Mm-hmm. So this is really like a question, not a question of we need a new license class. It's more like we just need to look at the technicians license, our foundation license, to make it more relevant. I mean, even the ARRL admits the survey could mean changes to the technician license, but it could also mean an additional but simpler license with privileges, blah blah blah. So we're looking at the technician question pool right now, and there's what's the duration of the question pool? How often does it get cycled around?
Every four years.
They all rotate every four.
Can I give a perspective here? This is not my opinion. This is somebody else who I've heard who I think has an interesting idea, but I'm not sure how accurate it is completely. It's two lines. Adults are scared of code. Kids are scared of tests. I'm not sure I agree with that 100%, but some people's reasoning is, look, kids take tests. I'm not saying this is my reasoning. Kids take tests all day. We go to school to take tests. Your goal is to pass all your tests. So when they get home, they really don't want to take a test. Code, on the other hand, can be viewed as a way to communicate, a way to kind of pass the message around. Whereas adults are terrified of the code, but to get through high school, to get through college, you take so many tests that it's ingrained on them at that
point. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure I agree 100% with that, but that's kind of one view of why people kind of support the two-page novice test. If you look at the old novice pamphlets, it was literally just a pamphlet, and it taught you what you needed to know. That was when it was still 1 year unrenewable. You had to have the code at 5 words a minute, but kids were willing to learn the code. And I'm not sure that we need to bring the code back, as much as some people view it as like an alternative pathway, I guess.
And if you ask the teachers, you know, like me or Carol or any of the people who've been teaching this for a long time,
right?
The way to get kids into ham radio, and I've done a show on this myself, the way to get kids into ham radio is get them on the air, get them hooked, mm-hmm. and talk about radio and the science and all those things of it.
Later.
It's not, hey, tell you what, you study this book and take a test.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's how you're going to get them into ham radio is, let's go take a test. I have enough tests already.
Every single year when we do Jamboree on the air with the Boy Scouts, and I'll have anywhere from 20 to 40 people show up for the day. I'll have scouts for a week after that saying, well, how do I get a license and how can I carry a radio and how can I do all the things that I did with you while you were watching me and you were being the station operator. And they don't understand that, but that's what they're trying to tell me.
Right. Yeah.
And then I give them a book and I say, there's 400 questions. You study this for a while. You have to pass, you know, 26 out of 35, and then you can have a license. And they go from like really excited to, oh, thanks, that was nice, we'll do something else now.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. You get them hooked and then they want to do it for themselves. How can I do it without having to have you as a control operator? Right. Well, here you go. Now, if you're that interested in it, now here's
waste all your
what
time
you have to do.
And we'll
stop
get,
studying
well,
for school.
I'll still get two or three every year that'll actually say, great, I'll have the book and I will take the test and they will get licensed.
Neal, do you remember how tough the novice was back 10%. When we took it?
Sorry, go ahead.
Do you remember how tough the novice was when we took it?
Yeah, it was tough.
The novice?
Well, I was 5.
That's right.
You got to remember,
I was 14.
They shot me down because I couldn't write my name in cursive. I had to resubmit it because I printed my name.
I'm shocked you're able to print your name at age 5.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to claim that the novice was pretty simple.
It was pretty simple. It was pretty simple.
And today, I think the tech is pretty simple. It might not be quite as simple as the novice was.
I'd argue there's a lot of stupid rules on the tech.
There's a lot of rote memorization. There's just a lot of numbers.
But as far as level of difficulty,
let's take a tech test for a second. This is from the AA9PW, one of my favorite practice tests because it's so clean. Yep. Doesn't have any ads.
And while
and stuff
I've been ranting here, let me say the question pool committee's got a tough job and they've done better. They have improved this from where it was.
But God knows how many grammatical errors there are on the damn test. One can sit down and correct for days on end.
Okay. Hazard of a 12 volt storage battery. Ozone? No. High voltage shock? No. Gas?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with C.
I'm going to go with C.
Yeah. They're not going to tell us whether we got them right till we get to the end.
I'm going
to
go with C.
The purpose of a gin poll. Man, I could have answered that. Because I didn't
you
use
can't
them,
answer
didn't
that
care.
Now or you couldn't answer that
I can answer it now, but there's a long period of my ham career.
My kids would say that's something that go along with the, with the club soda and the lawn.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. That's an example of one of the questions that's like, what is a new person coming into the hobby going to be doing on a tower? Like, maybe...
Who's
going to
be stacking row 25?
I feel like that's a learned skill or a learned part, a part of just like being a ham into that specific scene. It's not like you need to know what a gin pole is.
Not to go on a tangent here, but I'm going to go on a tangent here. there's been some political riffraff here the last few days, a little bit about that, where the latest cover of QST showed a young woman who showed a young woman.
Oh, bring up the picture, Gary.
We got to talk about that.
Yeah. With a loose harness with a piece of polypropylene rope out the back, zip tied together with a half.
Yeah. Two half hitches, two half hitches and two, zip ties. No, it should be a great follow through.
Right. And then the school came out and made a statement saying something on the lines of, we said they were learning how to climb a 300-foot tower, but
she was
they
4 feet
actually
off the ground.
They weren't actually,
you could tell, on it. You could tell the Photoshop. And like, we got to give the kids credit. Like, I mean, I don't think they were at any danger on this photo shoot.
I just wanted to point the clickbait headline. Could send high schoolers to their death.
Exactly.
Right. Well, I was kind of surprised.
That rope is two half hitches, and it needs to have a safety
figure
knot,
and
it needs to be a figure eight follow through, and then you don't need anything else, and it'll be fine. But those zip ties, no.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, why don't they put that in the tech test?
Yeah, as somebody who's done serious, and look, you scroll down, you see a loose harness, which is very dangerous. If you took a fall and weight came on the dorsal D-ring at the back there, you do see she has a 6-foot fall arrest lanyard clipped at her midsection. It should really be above her head. But
She's talking on the radio.
And she's talking on an unsecured radio.
It's not tethered.
Which is very dangerous. You tether all
her
tools.
Helmet.
Right. Her helmet, you need to have a chin strap.
Yep.
So what that's an example of is sloppy
clickbait.
Sloppy magazine production.
Right.
And I'll be honest, I actually tried to submit a picture of a person climbing a tower, but they wouldn't let me send it because the guy didn't have a hard hat. So the ARRL actually like has some checks and balances to make sure like they don't put stuff like that on there. But this was like clearly like, I guess there was like an agreement saying like, this isn't actually a person climbing a tower. There's a lot of safety gear on here, but it's not all connected together. Hopefully, and you know, much to their chagrin, hopefully nobody will catch it, but then, you know, it blew up. And I think personally, yeah, this picture shows a lot of terrible things you shouldn't do when you're climbing, but that's not the point, I feel. The point is you have this high schooler who is really involved in the hobby and doing something really great. You know, that, it's a cover photo.
And, sure. And I think that's definitely a point, but if you think about who you're sending this out to, you know, ARRL members, so maybe 200,000 hams who will tell you if you're 1 kilohertz below where your license privileges allow you to go. You had to know that somebody there was like, oh my gosh, we're going to catch heck for this.
And talk about monkey see, monkey do. I mean, monkey see zip tie, monkey do zip tie.
Yeah.
I like what one of the guys on Reddit said, which is, I always get all of my technical safety training from looking at the cover of a magazine.
Cover of UST. Okay,
yeah. I mean, to take a line from politics in the early 1990s, it's the economy, stupid. I mean, yeah. It's like,
how did we get here?
Yeah. But it's more.
That was Marty.
Thank
you for taking this, Sir Marty. I'm glad we talked about it. But back to the
back to what we're trying to talk about here.
I think what I want to kind of coalesce things into was that what we're looking for and what Neil was kind of asking, what we're looking for, I think, is a license that will get people interested in getting on ham radio without being a big barrier, a place to get started.
When we had our 4-hour marathon session. Was it day before yesterday, Gary? And Marty jumped in later on. There was comments in the chat room saying, hey, how about like an MCOM license, right? And maybe that's it, or maybe that's the new novice. I think there's maybe something along the lines. And then I thought about it a little more, but how about the off-roader license, or how about the backpacker license? So what is that low level? You've got to do just enough to show some kind of interest, proficiency, and they're not going to let all the crazy, wacky, prepper, lid, jerky, whatever people in.
I think there's a big difference between a prepper and a lid. Let's just make
I know. Yeah. Well, but I know a lot of crazy preppers. Okay.
Yeah. I don't think
you can't see the safe in my garage and the angle that we're on.
Okay? I don't think the exam is ever going to filter those people out. I mean, you put a question, are you going to be a lid or a prepper or a crazy CB-er? Yeah. Right. Yes. Okay. Yes. No.
Well,
how's it working right now?
It's not.
It's not.
It's not ever other not. Than that we're not inundated by those people.
Right. I mean, we talk. The funny thing is, a lot of preppers say, well, I'm not going to get licensed because I don't want to put my address somewhere where in an FCC database where everybody can search it. Have you ever heard of a PO box?
I mean, still, you got to pay for that.
Yeah, wait, Marty. Marty, do you know how much a PO box costs every month?
Oh, my God. $7. These people spend.
Well, maybe where you live.
Yeah. Over here, it's like $14.
God. Where I am, it's a lot more than that.
Yeah, because 100,000 people have a PO box, and they.
Well, you're in LAX, but then they say, "Well, it's okay because if there's a disaster, it'll be all right. I'll just get on the air because there's gonna be no FCC." But then us hams go, "Well, you'll be able to have a radio, but do you know how to tune a dipole? How about what band to be on at the right time? Tuner." LCs, maybe SWR. Even
how to use a repeater.
What is CQ? What is SSB, USB, LSB? What do all these things mean? You're not going to, I mean, it's a really flawed thinking.
It is one of the big flaws that I have seen in looking at a sampling of videos that are put out about ham radio, but from the disaster and prepper perspective, and that is you won't really learn enough about using that radio that you stowed away.
You'll be useless.
Now, one thing though that
they won't bother us.
They won't know how to transmit.
One thing that I saw in the survey, and I want to make sure that you know we do throw this in here, is remember when there were two different entry ways into ham radio? You could do a novice or you could do a technician. You could do one or the other, and you got different privileges if you started off with a no code tech, and the novice was still there, and it was a disaster.
Yeah, that was a brief period, and it was clunky.
You know, we ended up having to scrap it and say, you know, okay, now we're going to, you know, we had the novice, and then we had the tech, and then we had the tech plus that didn't actually have a license for the tech plus. It was tech plus. They had proof that they copied the code to give them a tech plus, but there wasn't a license tech plus, and it was just a disaster. So I think we need one basic stairway.
I think we've proven that the multiple
to make that work. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. All right. So I think we have been at the test level for all of our conversation so far. How about the privilege level? What should people be able to do, assuming that we come up with some sort of a one step below the tech? Marty, do you need to go to the bathroom? Is that what you're?
teacher.
I didn't bring my hall passes home from work, Marty. Sorry.
Okay, Marty, it's all yours.
It's all mine. Okay. Well, I don't know. I come at it with an interesting perspective. There's a lot of people, I guess, like what you're talking about, or what David talked about, the preppers, the hikers, the backpackers. But I come at it as a perspective of a guy who rarely gets on 2 meters. I always have a handy talkie on me. I have one right there in the corner here.
I was going to ask, you're so HF centric. Do you actually ever get on local repeaters?
Because I think it's important for me to get, I always value being able to kind of engage with my local community and kind of staying in touch with the local hams, because, you know, without becoming a prepper per se, you know, if the world goes to crap, I'd like to know my radios work, and, you know, having local ties never hurts. And, you know, it's fun to get on once in a while. I don't really make time to get on 2 meters, but if I have some free time, I enjoy, you know, talking to some locals. But, you know, I'm an HF guy. I have a HF radio here, there, and, you know, all over the place. And my perspective here is, let's get people on HF. Maybe I'm very interested in the notion of what we have in the UK, you know, the foundation license. Let's give them some low power 5-watt privileges, or 50 watts or 20 watts on all the HF bands, or some of the HF bands, or maybe only 20 meters, maybe only 40 meters. But let's get them a little bit of taste of HF phone.
If we give them less than 100 watts, if we give them 50 watts, then right. We are going to be saddled with 50 watt radios, and that's all we'll have. That's what happened on 220. When novices had 220.
Who's going to make those radios?
Yeah, when novices had 220 and a 25-watt level, all the radios available, were 25 watts. And
I'm not convinced that's really an issue on the HF market. Because the foundation license has been a killing success in the UK. And I guess that's definitely a smaller market than, for example, the US.
What's its power level?
5 watts.
HF.
So what if you make 150 and then you have to upgrade to use an amplifier?
I'd be okay with 100, 150. My concern is, look, we have a licensing system right now where any ham licensed in the U.S. who isn't a novice can run 1500 watts on 10 gigahertz. Let me just put this into perspective.
Yeah, that's definitely not responsible. I'm with
that's
you.
That's not
there,
responsible.
Marty. Yeah,
as
yeah,
somebody
yeah.
who's a serious VHF contester, like serious, like win, QRO, super high power on 10 gigahertz into these giant dishes is 10 freaking watts. But yet it's completely illegal for any ham to run 1500 watts and kill anybody within a big vicinity. That blows my mind.
I think in the microwave section, it's like kind of self-limiting, because once you get into that kind of stuff, once you get a 1500 watt amplifier, you should already kind of know this has got a lot of power on it. But I digress. There's a lot of idiots out there.
Yep.
I think My opinion on the privileges thing, I think HF is what got me in ham radio. It's what I, it was the bug that bit me.
It's
I was
bread,
in field
it's
day.
My bread and butter.
I think 100 watts is fine because all the radios are 100 watts and you can't control like a foundation person from actually putting out 5 watts, 10 watts, 100 watts, whatever, how many watts. But
you already know they're regulating power.
Just say 100 watts. And I want to give them data privileges because digital modes are cool. And I know I previously mentioned to Gary, like, digital modes don't give, aren't all that they're up to be. Like, it's not, like, a lot of people think, like, digital modes are the way to get young people into ham radio, but it's really the entirety of the idea, with digital modes being the most relevant.
I mean, I look at who I see on digital modes when I get on PSK. Most of those people are 70-year-olds who can't talk real quick.
Well, that's most hams, I feel.
But
you know.
But on the other hand, what mode of communication are young people using the most right now?
Texting, as you say.
Yeah.
And the point which I'm going to try and balk at before you can even get there is, what's going to make a teenager want to text on ham radio if they can text on their phone? We don't need a match. We need to do something else. I mean, look, I can take a small radio. This happens to be the radio that's hitting my shack. It's, you know, just a standard ICOM. In the for less than $1,000, you can get a box that's 5 pounds.
That box is not $1,000.
It's an $1,100 box. This box can talk all around the world with an appropriate power supply, a wire antenna. This box can send CW. This box has a color touchscreen. Look what this. I'm not saying you have to buy this box, but I think we should be saying, look, you could get a box that can fit in your backpack, and you can talk around the world. To me, that's the magic of radio, that I can hook this up to a wire outside my window and make contacts all around the world. That's the appeal we need to send.
I think that magic is what really connects us all together, and it was the whole like foundation of amateur radio in itself to advance the art and science of ham radio.
Part 97.
Modernizing in looking into the future, ham radio seems to be more and more spreading out to makers, and you more or less using ham radio as a tool for their expansion of whatever their hobby is. Because ham radio has the power levels, it has the spectrum, it has the capabilities that, you know, ISM, 2.4 gig, that stuff doesn't have. I think that, going back to my other point, I think that there should be HF privileges. I almost think that single sideband or phone should be limited or something, because that would provide a little bit of incentive to get a further license class, I feel. Like, if you don't have voice, but you have data, You can do all the cool data things that hackers like to do, but it incentivizes you if you want to be on a single sideband contest or something, then bump up to the next license class. I think VHF should also come down a little bit. Like, they should only get 2 and 440 and maybe 33 centimeters, 1.2, but beyond that, like, limit it to some particular sections of the band, FM only maybe, just to get a taste. And I feel like that taste would be enough. But I know, just by saying that, there's some lots of opposition that says, why don't you just give them all of it? You know, so I'd be open to hear that.
Well, you know, I'd wonder, like, you know, there's a lot of, we talked about makers and whatever, and there's a lot of drones out there that'll work on 2.4 or 5 gigahertz, right?
People want longer range drones, too.
What's that?
And
that's my point. If we were really seeing the explosion in those areas, and I'm not sure we aren't, if you went to a makerspace or you went to people that are really into the maker movement and said, hey, you know, your drone's limited to, because that's all that the open license for 2.4 or 5.8 allows you. But if you go get your amateur radio license, that opens you up to higher power and opens up the band where you can take that drone, and instead of only flying it, you know, 1,000 feet from where you are, you can take it a mile out or more. I think by now we'd be seeing more penetration in those areas, more people participating, but we're not making the impact. And it goes back to what we talked about yesterday, Gary, or the day before, which is, it's not up to the FCC to push where we're going. It's up to organizations like the ARRL to push groups like Aries and the clubs and whatever to open up and educate and bring more people into the hobby and expose them to what they could do, rather than like dumbing down the test or changing the test to bring more people in, because that's not going to be what does it.
Mm-hmm.
It's the organizations that are going to bring people in. There's having more Elmers, having more education, having more availability for people to go somewhere and learn about, here's what I can do with that amateur radio license, which is really going to drive us from 740,000 to over a million hams in the United States in the next 2, 3, 5 years.
And it's go ahead, Marty.
I mean, I feel like to some level, there's the, it's not what you can do for ham radio, it's what ham radio can do for you. And I'm convinced that those people who want the more privileges, who want to run higher power, I'm not sure they really want, they need the license to do that. There's a lot of people, look at all the people who run, you know, radios on the ham bands to talk to their paintball boys, as we were talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. They don't care to get licensed.
Nope.
They create issues for us, but that doesn't mean they care to get licensed. And what I see, what I see kind of is that, look, let's get people excited, but I don't think we should be making this kind of wide appeal to say, let's make ham radio work for you. I think we should show what ham radio is, why it excites us, and if you want to join, join, and if not, maybe you don't. But I'm not sure we should really be shaping it so much. Sure, let's show them what they can do, what it can do for them. But I'm not sure we should be going out of our way so much to say, how can we kind of, you know, this is, everybody says I'm an 80-year-old ham sometimes, and this is probably me being my 80-year-old ham.
Not a day over 68,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's the, well, how far do we take it? And I'm not so sure.
Is there this bubbling pool of potential hams sitting just below our current licensing level that if we drop it a little bit, we'll scrape or float them all in? I've tried to keep the metaphor aligned.
I don't know. And I think really, I think what we should really be focusing on is not getting new hams into the hobby, but let's help the hams who just got licensed. Let's help the people who are inactive get licensed and enjoy the hobby. Because where people struggle a lot of time is they get licensed and they get their CSCE, whatever it is, and they're thrown out the door. Let's stop. Let's give people Elmers. Let's reach out. Let's join together. Let's help you string up a dipole.
And that's what I was just getting ready to say was it's unfortunate that it's not practical to have an apprenticeship or a required Elmer for a period of time as a requirement for your license, because that would probably be much more practical than test questions. But I don't think that's practical.
It would be a burden on the rest of us.
Yeah, and this isn't.
But I don't think it's.
This isn't,
I don't
like think getting a pilot's idea. License.
Yeah, exactly. Or learning how to be a plumber or an electrician.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but it is the real answer. Because if we're looking for some kind of different test to do the job for us, it's not going to do it.
We have to do the job ourselves.
Yeah, and we're not.
There's a lot. I mean,
oh no!
Look, everybody, look at the audience, and you know, steering your cameras and say,
blame you.
If you haven't done anything to help bring in a new ham or help a new ham get deeper into the hobby, then you're the problem.
And I also, I mean, I think there's some level, there's obviously lots of responsibility on us. And I think the easy scapegoat is the ARRL. And so, almost somewhat valid too. I mean, I think they preach a lot about what they could do, but I'm looking to see at the same time real results. What can the league do? They represent us. I think most of us probably are members. Most of us pay dues. What can they do? Because they are in a stance to do something. They keep talking about things they can do. They keep talking about license manuals to get people interested. But I never see in their literature helping hams get on the air. You're selling textbooks is not the answer.
I think it's got to be more local than what they could do. And they might be able to provide help to someone at that ground, that your grassroots level at a club.
From their little, from their little building in, where are they?
Newington, Connecticut.
And it's not Connecticut. From their little building in Connecticut, that's about all that they can do. And like I said, you know, looking at how they can go to the Aries group and the NTS organizations and just your regular radio club.
Yeah.
They need to provide material and supplies. Like I don't love, there are some podcast celebrities out there in the amateur radio world that do books and go to conventions and sign flyers and make lots of noise. You know who I'm talking about, right?
Yep.
I don't love the way he does it, but he's out there in the trenches saying, hey, you need to do more than do the test. You need to bring a lot of stuff. And you need to show them things. You need to get them excited.
You're
and
quoting
you need to,
him like, now, word for word, too.
Set a pickle on fire to get people excited about it, right?
Now we all know who you're talking about.
Now you need to talk in a big animated voice.
As if there
voice.
Were a doubt.
And you know what? I think he's like two or three steps away from the right thing, closer than I am. But that's the way things need to go. Have fun, Marty.
He'll be back.
Yeah, I know he will. And, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, and Sterling will chime in on this, I'm sure. But I mean, that's part of what we're doing, you know, at the high school level, and a lot of the schools with activities is we focus on getting them on the air, getting them involved, getting them doing stuff, and the focus is not on, hey, you get to take another test. And so having these activities like the colleges and the college initiative, you know, now to where we help those colleges get going. And then there's another high school thing coming up soon, too, that if we can equip those places, then those places can do the Elmering and the activities and things like we do with bringing in kids into the high school club that, you know, they're getting into school club roundup. They're getting into portable operations. They're learning how to set things up. And I think that's great that they're pushing that because that's a way to get it at that grassroots level.
Yeah. Sure. The collegiate thing.
I set you up, Sterling. Go.
Yeah, I know. I forgot to mention when we were doing introductions that I was a part of the Collegiate Amateur Radio Initiative, and they are doing an incredible job. And I mean, we haven't really had much time to do much. Like the only real deliverable, the only real thing that has come out of it is a Facebook group, a GroupMe group chat. And the collegiate forum at Hamcation, which was super successful. We live streamed it, and it seems like it's gotten tons of views. And those who are involved on the Facebook group, it's about 400 members now, are really digging deep into either regenerating their club, starting licensed classes, and doing more fun stuff. At AAA, at W0AAA, we weren't about, you know, we're, you know, a tight-knit group of snobby hams who have to take a license to get in our, you know, our shack, our closed-off little clubhouse. We always had an open door for every contest. I always tweeted out, W0EEE is on the air, and for every sweepstakes, every school club roundup, we always try to get people on the air. We always had the radios blaring so you could hear them in the hallways, and people would come up and go like, oh, what's that? We'd be like, sit down. And they would get on the air, and they would go like, wow, that's really cool. And for the longest time, a lot of our members never even got a license because, well, we were all in college. We had college classes. So they'd operate third party. They'd hang out at the meetings, and they'd be a part of the club. And so, I mean, I know some older hams who, even in the SLSRC, the St. Louis Radio Club, who still don't have a ham radio call sign. And they're just in ham radio because it's fun to hang out with these people. And it's just not their thing to take the test and do this and that. So that's an interesting side of the colleges, and the ARRL has been doing something like with that, and I can see where the collegiate initiative is going can easily be applied to the high school. And you know, obviously, Neal, you probably can talk about like the Teachers Institute and what they do for teachers and schools of primary education, I guess I should say. Sure. They do grants, scholarships, that sort of stuff. And I feel like that stuff's not advertised and talked about enough. Because I'll be like, hey, Triple E, scholarships. And they'll be like, what? You know, they'll be like, holy cow. That stuff exists.
I just found a demo here to what we were talking about, to teaching towards the task. And that is a textbook that I pulled out from a ham radio textbook. Let me see if I can get in the shot. And what is it? Every page. Let me move my mic here so you can hear me. Every page, I should focus now because I've been on auto, is questions and answers. Questions and answers. Mm-hmm. There's occasionally, a picture. But that's about it. Questions and answers, no explanations. Not so subtle hint who wrote it. but I don't think studying a book, questions and answers, is the way to teach it anymore. Although I think said person has the right idea that, you know, let's teach ham radio in a hands-on way. Let's make cues on 2 meters to learn how to use a repeater. Just to kind of jump back there. I didn't want to
sideline. Yeah, so, I have a slightly different. So here's the thing. My Elmer's, right, when I got licensed in, back end of 2011, beginning of 2012, the couple that they do quarterly classes every year, and they've done it for the last, I will tell you, 10, 15, 20 years here, and they're responsible for hundreds and hundreds of ham getting licensed. They do a class, but it's 3 sessions, right? The first day is a cram, and at the end of the day you take your test, and then you go back a week later, and then they talk about, here's what you need to know about the stuff you can do with your technician's license, primarily UHF, VHF, because that's the thing you can walk into HRO, or you can go to Amazon.com and for $100 or $200 have a radio and get active, right? Mm-hmm. And then a week later they're like, okay, now we gave you a recommendation. If you bought a radio, bring it in, we'll program it, we'll test it out, we'll talk, we'll have people in from some clubs, hopefully we'll get you hooked up with who might be your Elmer. That's the way to do it. That's the right model, yeah, right? Exactly. And it's not just learn to the test, teach the test, get your technician license, and you're out on your own, and good luck.
And the Teachers Institute that Sterling talked about was, first of all, the single best professional development conference I've ever gone to as a teacher. And there were maybe 2 other hams in the dozen people in my group, but 3 or 4 of them took the test before they left. The emphasis was not on teaching the test. The emphasis was on teaching the science behind electromagnetic waves and how all this works, and get into, a little bit into robotics and some coding and how electronics works and how you can get kids active in using these things and learning about these things so that at some point they would want to study and get a license. Yeah. And so that was a way to, get everybody involved and show them how to do that, and then start Elmering those people.
If you're really into this, if you're really kind of advanced on the scale like Marty, right? So, you're a ham beyond your years, right? If you're very geeky, if you're geeky, if you're a maker, if you're very into the technology things, I agree that's the way to go. But if you're a Boy Scout or a backpacker, or if you want to be involved in CERT or MCOM, teaching the theory of why, if you take 12 volts and you add a 10 ohm resistor, what do you get out of it? It's completely useless. Okay. It's not going to drive more people to the hobby. If you get them their license and get them involved, then maybe a year down the road or 2 years down the road, they're going to look at general, and they're going to start looking at theory, and they're going to start looking at what circuits really do. But you've got them on the radio, and you've got them experience so that they can move forward. I get a lot of the audience, maybe the Martys and the people interested in making, but there's a lot of other ones out there that we leave behind if we're just teaching electrical theory and what a resistor will do, and all those other things that, when we talked about in the beginning of the show, it's completely irrelevant to, I've got this radio, I'm going to pick it up, and I'm going to push the button, I'm going to talk.
Marty, do you know what you want to be when you grow up?
Probably an RF engineer.
Okay. So the two guys on the top of the screen are engineers, and the two guys on the bottom of me over here, not an engineer.
Can I ask a question?
Well, let me make a point because I've been real quiet for a long time. I've been real loud. I have a beef.
This is what happens when you get all these podcast hosts on a show.
Yeah. I could shut you all up.
He has the button.
Yes, you have the magic button.
You do tonight. Have the button. Yep. And you've been really nice about it.
Yep. Really. I'm just sitting here petting cats.
That's really entertaining, too.
I have a bit of a beef with the engineering side of ham radio because I am not and never have been an engineer. My engineering knowledge is all practical, and it all came out of ham radio, and it served me well in my career. But my career has been a really sophisticated and occasionally high-paid button pusher. I call myself George Jetson, you know, push television buttons, and pretty good at it. And it helped to know something about what went on behind the control panel, but most of my peers never did. And my appreciation and career in ham radio has not been high on the engineering scale. I call myself king of the appliance operators. Should ham radio be an engineer's license or should it be a communicator's license? Can it be both?
I don't want to give the impression that the Teachers Institute was solely that either, because we did satellite contacts. We did, you know, robotics. We did, antennas. We did those things that went with it. But the big thing was activity. It was pushing the activity and the experience of using things to get them hooked. And then they want to study.
This reminds me a little bit of Carol Perry, who is the director of youth activities for the RC, the Radio Club of America. She runs the Dayton Youth Forum. She's fantastic. She's a lovely woman. And she taught amateur radio as a class for a very long time in the New York public school system, New York City public schools, I want to say. I could be getting this wrong. Neal will correct me. And she never taught a licensing class.
Yep.
Her class, which she taught for well over 20 years, I believe, was an amateur radio class. People learned code. People got on the air and they made contacts. If you wanted to get your license, she'd pass you on to somebody else. But I thought that was brilliant. It's a class that everybody took. Your goal is not to get licensed. It was exposure. It was fun ham radio. I'm not sure, but I got the impression that Ohm's Law, IER, was never taught. I have the impression that they didn't spend time trying to calculate the velocity of factor of a coax to make it a quarter wave at 7 megahertz to delay a vertical by 90 degrees so you can generate an end-fire pattern.
Oh, but they did do Smith charts.
Okay.
No, they did. Oh, I'm kidding.
That's pretty much that.
Right. You're absolutely
That's right. One of the questions I missed on my extra test. The Smith chart question.
Yeah. Me too.
I missed two.
That was my favorite question.
She'll tell you that, you know, they made these little bitty code oscillators, and these kids love code. They love tapping out secret messages. And I just did it at the high school. I got offered a code class, and I had 21 kids show up. Three of them were in Ham Radio Club. Three.
So I'm trying to learn code, and I got the rhythm of the code music. I don't know if
you know. Oh, yeah.
My daughters are up to like 12 or 15 letters because they think it's cool. Yeah. I don't know what they're going to do with it.
Faster than dad.
I know.
Dad's going to have some serious...
I will fully admit I'm the village idiot here on the island here, and they'll all be smarter than I will, and they'll all do better than I will. But they got into it. It was kind of cool.
Yeah.
But that's exactly what Carol was about. And I took, you know, that lesson and ran with it because, you know, sticking a book and a test in front of a kid is not going to turn them on to ham radio. And she's done that with great success. and taught that as a course in the middle school for decades. And
great success.
Yeah. And, you know,
great success, but not
if we don't get them licensed, at least they know what ham radio is.
So, great success, but not replicated enough across the country or the world to make a significant difference. You know, something you can point to, what Carol has done and what Neil has done and a few other hams in a few areas have done, and you can point to them and say, isn't this awesome?
But you can count them on your hand.
We got to do that everywhere.
You can count it on your hand, and that's not going to be effective.
Yeah.
But I can count them on my hands, toes, and all the antennas in the yard, then we'll turn. Yeah.
All right, so do the five of us need to put together the proper lessons plan and direction to go to bring to the masses so that we can get people educated the way the five of us think that we should?
I'm a podcaster.
I mean, 10 hams, all right. 12 opinions, 5 microphones.
All right. Well, I'm now a podcaster, but I'm an educator too, and all those other things, and maybe there's something there.
Yeah.
There is a group working on that, by the way.
Working on coming up with a better way in?
With a curriculum for high school.
Yes, I know the ARRL is also involved with that.
Yeah.
God help them.
I hope they get there.
We can talk about this off.
When I was in high school in the 60s, I won't say most, but many, many high schools had ham radio clubs. Mine did. Mm-hmm. And you know, many around the area did. Now
I know very few high schools with active clubs.
Yeah.
And schools don't seem to be interested. When I've approached schools, when I've approached my schools, they look at it as a liability. Kids, RF, radios, antennas.
Well, they need
the educational side.
They need an educator there that's licensed and can manage the whole process. Otherwise, you're a liability. And
right.
how many teachers at your school, Marty, have even a tech license?
And trying to talk them into it is impossible. The only way you could be successful with this is sounding really pessimistic, but my view in the modern day is it's nearly impossible for a school to sustain a radio club unless you have a faculty that's 200% on board, committed, and is licensed. And you're just going to fail if you don't have that. I mean, it's a sad reality, but look at liability insurance at the moment.
And that's where
I've been there.
Teachers Institute is trying to fill a void there to train teachers that aren't hams or that are hams, that, you know, with some activities and some lesson plans and some things that they can do to get people turned on to that. And then there's the grant program where we got a whole station. I mean, they sent us everything to the, you know, from the radio down to the PL-259s to put on. And we had, you know, the whole station there, and we just went through and raised the money ourselves and through donations to revamp the whole station now, you know, 13 years later. But as the weather radio goes off in the background,
I was wondering.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who was that? That's you?
Yeah, that's the weather radio.
Are you safe?
Yeah.
Oh, it's not an alarm.
It shut off. But anyway, it's a watch. But anyway, you know, people will ask me all the time, well, I want to get a ham radio group started in a high school. I want to get this, you know, started in a middle school. How do I do this? And I tell them about the grant program, and they have no idea that, you know, ARRL has this program that will make that easy, that will take that load off of them. If you just have some kind of a plan to show what you are going to do, and you've got the support of someone within the school, which again is hard to do. But if you have somebody there that, you know, they can say, well, there's a reasonable chance this is going to actually get used, then that's provided. And programs like that, is something that the ARRL can do nationwide, where, like Gary said, you know, a lot of the actual hands-on stuff may have to be more local.
And I think that's the key. It needs to be local, but I'd love to see some more guidance from on high on best practices and how to bring it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it has to be grassroots, but it also has to come from the top down. Like, hey, local radio clubs, here's stuff you can do to get interest up. Because, like, I'm in a few ham radio clubs that are really struggling to get new members, and they're coming to me, and they're trying to generate organic ideas of what to do, which is great and all, but there's never in, you know, my short, you know, 10 years of being a ham, there's never been really anything from the top down saying, like, hey, small radio club, try this, go put
flyers
up.
Here's some strategies that have worked.
Yeah.
Let us pass on. We don't have to be an inventor, but if we can pass on some ideas that we've seen work that other people have done from the grassroots.
Yeah.
Here's some ideas.
I think that'll bring a lot more
than
a new license class.
Right. Maybe the key thing for the ARRL to do is not to be, poking around with FCC licenses. Maybe to put a person at headquarters who's a coordinator, whose job is to reach out to clubs, to help support clubs,
That is a job, isn't it?
They have club coordinators. It's curriculum, Marty. They need to develop the curriculum for the clubs to be able to bring the new hams in and teach them what they need to know so that they have the skills so that they can go out and do the things they want to do. It's not just to say, bring them in.
Right. Well, I think that exists on some level, but I'm not sure. I mean, I know there's things in the works, but thus far I haven't been impressed, but we will see.
Yeah. And I haven't seen it.
Yeah. I mean, what they're doing with colleges right now is basically what they need to do for all radio clubs. I feel. They're going to the grassroots. They're saying, hey, colleges, here's what you need to do. Here's some activities. Here's some, you know, videos and inspiration, basically. Take that, apply it to any ham radio club that, you know, is affiliated. There's like, what, 80%, 90% of the ham radio clubs out there with just a simple newsletter or a simple campaign similar to the CARI, College Amateur Radio Initiative. And I think that would go way farther than doing licensing changes around. And that's not to say, like, maybe a foundation license can really, like what Gary said earlier, there might be a few hams just sitting and waiting for an easier way to get their foot in the door. But, you know, who knows? I'd really like to see the outcome of the survey, because from here, like Marty said, you have five people and six or seven or ten opinions. I can't really keep count.
So 15. For you guys, how many people that you know that you've said, hey, go get an amateur radio license, that was interested in it, went and tried and did not succeed?
Well, I will never know, because, I mean, through the ham radio club at college, I've done that to probably hundreds of people that just come in and sign up. And
you don't know from the long term, did they try? And
right. I know specifically of two people who did and who never really came part of the ham radio club, but they ended up using their ham radio license for like the satellite team. And I never saw them again until like I saw them in the news saying like, oh, they're on the satellite team using ham radio. I'm like, what? I need to have something to do with that. So I, you know, went over and met the guy, and he was like, hey, yeah, I met you from Minorama, which was like our little student organization event on campus. He signed up, he got a newsletter, got some information. I just put in a bunch of stuff, like, here's what the license is, how to get a license. I post a lot of videos on the like premise of ham radio. I actually made a video called First Contact, and this is kind of funny.
ARRL video contest.
I think I might have talked about it the last time. ARRL had a video contest. Limit was 5 minutes capturing the excitement of your first contact and ham radio in general. It's 5 minutes. I made it 17 minutes long, but turns out that's my second most watched video on YouTube. I think it's got 40,000 views, and it's been up for about 6 years or so. And it's cringeworthy.
Sterling.
Because they think it's cool.
But
I don't know what they're going to do with it.
Now, they're going to go faster than dad.
Is that you, Sterling?
Yeah.
It looks awesome. More like me than it does like him.
Awesome.
This took about 17 takes to get right in one shot. But I don't know. It just ended up being long, but it turns out that video inspired like way more people than I could have ever imagined.
I gotta say, doesn't Sterling look a little bit like me in that photo? I feel like it looks more like me than it does look like
weird.
A little blonde, you
agree.
Yeah.
Is it uncanny resemblance?
Let me play a little bit of the sound here.
Jeez. done that
here at our main operating table.
Success.
We have a variety
you're going the wrong way.
Mostly radio.
Okay, guys.
Here we have an IC-746
and an FT-847. Over here, some older equipment.
Yeah.
And our tuner. You know. And
Something weird is playing in addition to that. What else is making noise here?
What was it? Facebook?
Yeah.
Maybe in the background?
Yeah, Facebook's open or something.
It shouldn't be. Well, yeah, it might be.
Do you have the latent audio coming back somewhere?
Oh, yeah, that might be happening.
So I just go and describe the club, and later on, I think I had three people do their actual first ham radio contact ever.
Isn't that so exciting when you see somebody, they sit down, they make a cue. You know, 70% of them don't care, but the 30% who are hooked, it's always amazing every time I see it.
And we hooked them. Hooked them good. I'm still really good friends with all the people I met and got hooked in that video. So, and they're not as hammy as we are. They're, you know, they have a license, but they have gone pretty inactive. But among all the inactive hams, they're the guys who still have a, you know, HT sitting on their desk at work or at school or in their car. Like they're, you know, they're kind of always there and they know about what ham radio is all about, which is what we were talking about a minute ago. Like that's really imperative
It may be a better, you know, question for Neal or Gary. Like, you know, I know all of the people I've ever sent that have shown interest and mostly I'll admit mostly it's around Boy Scouts, right? If an adult or even a scout has said, "Hey, I'm interested," I give them the book and I say, "Hey, I'll tell you when the quarterly test, you study a little bit, you come take the test, you get your license." Every single one of them that applied themselves, and I'll say it applied themselves, and there's only maybe 25 people that I've gotten licensed through that method. Two of the people I sent didn't apply themselves, they didn't get their license, and they never went and tried again. But all the other people have. So if you're interested and you're motivated, again, back to the topic of our conversation today is, do you change it or don't you change it? If you want to do it, you'll do it and you'll get it done. Now, I don't know if maybe we should give them more privileges or allow them to do more things or maybe dumb it down for the two that didn't pass. I don't know. Neal, have you sent people or recommended people and they did or they didn't get through the process?
Yeah, I've had some that didn't get through the process. And again, it a lot of times it comes down to applying, you know, themselves. It's not necessarily that they couldn't do it. It's that they took 20 billion AP classes all at the same time and they're way overloaded and they didn't have time to prepare. And so they just showed up hoping that they would pass. And sometimes they'll come back and redo that. And sometimes they don't. But I don't think the level of difficulty of the test is really an issue. I think it's more of taking the time to learn it and being relevant.
I mean, I for sure think that, you know, a high schooler is a very busy person these days, more busy than ever, I'd say. And I think there's definitely been times in my middle school and high school careers where I've majored in ham radio and minored in school. And that's not always the right thing to do.
That was my story.
It's certainly not always the most academic thing to do. I've survived thus far, but I think there's definitely something to say, you know, for a parent who's kind of pushing their child, I think a parent is much more likely to say, take a third AP class than they are going to say, go get your technician license. I just think that's how colleges probably actually, in my humble opinion, if I were a college, I know this isn't always how colleges work. If I saw an extra class amateur radio operator, that tells me that they know how to study, they know how to take tests, they know how to learn technical theory. Mm-hmm. To me, that says a lot.
If you're going to go to Virginia Tech, it'll mean something, right? Because they have a really good program there and they push for that. But if you go to UCLA or Stanford or, you know, pick the name of the college in Boston, they don't care.
However, on that note, if you put it on your resume, they will come. Like both of my jobs have been as a direct result of ham radio. Like, you know, when my employer now was walking me around the floor introducing me, I was like, "Oh, you're the ham. He's the ham. He's going to be our radio guy."
And right, but what do you do, Sterling? What do you do, Sterling?
I do radio stuff.
Right, exactly. You do radio stuff. Yeah. So in my world, so like you know, I have been an engineer in the IT world, but, you know, now I'm an analyst. In my world, it doesn't mean anything. It means you're like, you're resurrecting some goofy old thing that maybe the boss's grandfather did in his garage.
Yeah.
You still do that? True.
I know in my, I do some work, which is technical, some software stuff and some IP phone system stuff. And multiple clients on my, you know, on my little business card, it says ham radio operator, amateur radio operator, KC1CWF. And that has started a lot of discussions before.
Yeah.
And although probably 80% of the time it's either ignored or it's just a one question deal, that other 20% of the time it pays off in dividends.
Yep. Yep. It does.
And this may be a generational thing. Early part of my career, early and mid part, every employment I got had a ham radio connection. And since 1990, none of them did. And they're all the same, you know, radio stations, TV production companies, things like that. But early on, it made a big difference. And you know, mentors were hams, and then couldn't find any. They weren't there. I freelanced for a major university or major public FM radio station, one of the biggest ones in the country. And there were no other hams there. They didn't have a big engineering department, you know, only a handful of engineers at that point, but they didn't care. I think we got to be about done. I wanted to point out one thing.
We're over an hour and a half.
Yeah. One thing that I saw here, the league has a lot of things that they have developed that nobody knows about. This is one of the things you guys were talking about. It, you know, it wasn't hard to find on their website. But it's not something you can hear the league talking about very much. Many of the things that you find are not really active. I suppose if you were to go ask about some of those things, you would find no one's really running that program anymore. But, you know, it's all on the website. Mm-hmm. But maybe somebody is. Maybe it's, you know, somebody's secondary position and they just don't get much traction on it. But if you come and ask, they'll pull out the brochures and stuff.
So, I've noticed on their website they have a lot of good information just like in their embedded in their inside website, but that's the thing, you have to go find it. It's you might be able to find it through Googling if you're, you know, lucky, but I'm sure there'd be ways.
Getting the word out is always hard.
Yeah,
it really is. It's really tough,
and it's repetitive. Like, you got to keep doing it, and like going back and really getting the word out. Even though you have a magazine, you have like 200,000 listeners, it's still, you know, I agree.
You know, we've been running this live stream for over an hour and a half. We've now dropped to nobody but me watching.
Yeah, and you know, that's okay, Marty, because we'll post it up there and people will watch it. Yeah. And that's
I understand.
The Facebook Live. Everybody's watching the Trumpanzee right now.
We got some competition. We got Donald Trump and we've got W5KUB. Yeah.
We also got a massive storm outbreak going on. So I can understand, but people will come to this later.
What I'm saying is they'll be on
podcasts and stuff.
This has been a great conversation and it's been a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
To be here with you guys.
So bottom line, new license or not?
I would not be opposed to it. I think that it is not going to be any kind of a panacea, but if the technician license is not, if we have trouble, like David has said, if we have trouble getting people across the hump of, oh, this is really cool stuff, and here you're going to do your studying. Oh, well, maybe next week. Mm-hmm. If we could come up with a way to get people over that barrier and get them in so that they could play with some of our radios, and then as they see the other things they can do, you can say, well, now you've got to do some upgrading, the old incentive thing. And by the way, Neil, for those guys that complained about losing their privileges when incentive licensing came around, that was a snapshot in time that was a very brief one in ham radio when the general had all privileges. Yeah. 10 years before that, there were several layers of licenses and different privileges, and then they got scraped away, and it was just the general for a while, but not more than 15 years. So,
but the animosity.
Well, yeah. Well, because
carried.
Yeah. As Jeff, my friend Jeff AC Ford likes, AC Ford ZO likes to say, complaining goes directly to the pleasure center of the brain.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Hams are good at that.
And hams are really like good at whining.
It's only been about the like past.
Really bad at making change.
Back in my day, you know, back when I took the test and had to walk to school uphill both ways through 10 feet of snow without any shoes in the middle of a sharknado.
Man, you got that script down
pat. Yeah, I use that one a lot, you know. this is how I took the test. And you know, oh, there's that no code ham, you know. And it's like, well, okay, maybe this person gets into electronics. Maybe this person gets into code. Maybe this person gets into digital. Maybe this person gets into phone. Maybe this person gets into public service. There's so many facets of ham radio that, you know, you can't just focus on one.
Ward Silver gave a talk at the Tapper Conference banquet a couple years ago, and he asked this question of the group. When was the golden age of amateur radio? And
I know what I would say.
Yeah, and nobody raised their hand but me. And he says, Gary, I think you know the answer. I said, yeah, whenever I got licensed. He added a plus or minus a couple of years, but
what do you have at mid-70s?
I was licensed in 65, but
yeah, I'm not sure. Yeah.
Almost every activity that someone gets into, not just ham radio, but anything, when you came upon it, it was the way it was supposed to be. And yeah, it right. changes after that. We're all for the worse. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure why I went down the incentive licensing rabbit hole, although it's only been maybe 10 years that I haven't heard that come up at every ARRL forum.
Yeah.
Someone complaining about it. It still comes up now and then, but it's much, much more rare.
It's much more silent.
Yeah. So I'm not
silent.
Yeah. So you need to get the noisy keys talking about that, Sterling.
Yeah,
Marty.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I would say that I would expect it to be a panacea, but if it's something that can bring people in over that, make a low enough threshold that we get them interested by demonstrating, letting them participate some, and then
have to participate
and let them keep that interest by being able to immediately step in with a very low barrier, just enough of a barrier that it takes a little bit of skin in the game.
Yeah. I think my kind of take on it is, it sounds like this call sign thing, if it works, great, but on the outside, it really looks like a clutch to fix. It's a clutch. It's a band-aid on the issue. And I think what we really need to be doing is focusing on what we can do as hams, not how we can fix it by making the FCC do paperwork.
and to much of a great extent, we're not, which right. is
for sure.
Some of us are not.
Yeah.
Some of us are not.
Which is when a new ham arrives through the licensing classes that we've got, they don't walk into the hobby with no additional help. I had plenty, but it was all personal.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I've had a lot too.
I did too. And I did too.
Yeah. Yep. But there's too many people that don't. And those are
we're the ones doing the podcast. Yeah. I mean,
and the folks that there may be some watching here who made it all the way to the end of the show that say, yeah, I got my license, but I never did anything with it.
Shoot me an email now.
Shoot me an email now. Yeah. Our coding classes at the end, when they're waiting to find out if they passed or not, I give them the pitch, you know, come join us. We'll teach you. We'll help you. We'll be there for you. We'll be your Elmer. That's what we need to be doing.
Yeah.
Right. I want to hear, David.
Join us.
How many, before we wrap things up here, how many new hams join Aries in your area every year?
Dozen.
How many of them do more than two events a year out of those dozen?
Well, of the 200, the only ones that do the more than two events a year are about 30.
Yeah.
And, you know, what I'll tell you is, of those 30, four of them are the new hams. Maybe
that's five. Good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how long do those new hams seem to stick around for?
It kind of varies, but the new ones that you get and you get them hands on and you get them participating and you get them interested, That's where I was 6 years ago. Now I'm an EC. Now I'm doing a podcast. Right. And not all of them will do it. And, you know, it's the way of the world.
One thing I'll mention and give a shout out to a local ham, Tad, KA2DEW. Our local radio club meeting starts at 7:30. At 6 o'clock, he took it upon himself to establish the new ham gathering.
Ooh, that's a good idea.
If you're new, or if you've been around for a long time, but you just want to ask questions and have some Elmering, come at 6 o'clock and you'll get, usually he has something prepared, but he'll always sit around and talk, and a few other, you know, more experienced ham show up just to help answer questions and, you know, do some one-on-one. That's one thing that every radio club could do. But it's only done if somebody says, I'm the guy who's going to do it.
An hour a month. It won't take a lot of time. 12 hours a year. And it's things like having an Elmer available. How do you throw the rope over the tree to hang the dipole? Those things are really hard if you don't know what you're doing.
How do you attach the rope to the back of your harness?
Right. Use zip ties.
No zip ties. The right knot.
22 kilonewton.
I think I may have worn a full body harness to climb one tower one time. More just the ordinary old-fashioned belt. Way too many free climbs with nothing.
I think I spent over $700 between and hams are cheap. Hams don't want to spend that. Between the harness, the hard hat, which is really important, the boots, which are worth gold. With a steel shank to dual leg lanyards to a positioning harness, positioning lanyard, they'll save your life. $700 is so much cheaper than a funeral.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And I do rappelling and mountain climbing, so I just have that kind of harness, and I would use it when I needed to. And it's the way, you know, you do what you got to do.
Yeah, and right. You know, even a Petzl rock climbing harness, although it's not perfect, it'll save your life.
Let's wrap this puppy up. I'll do the
Can we stick a Patreon already pitch here. In here?
Sorry, Marty, go ahead.
I said, can we stick a money pitch in here?
Oh, for your guys? Yeah, sure.
Oh, yeah, by the way, we have a podcast too.
Yeah, and I think we're going to stick this out as an episode.
Okay.
Like last time.
Okay, so this is another Phasing Line Ham Radio Now mashup.
Yes.
That's right. I'm sending you the audio file.
Okay. And if you like this show and you want to hear more of this, please go to our website, phasinglinepodcast.com. Let me stick my grubby little hands into your wallet. I'm going to peel it open. I'm going to take that credit card. I'm going to have you enter the credit card number into our website. You're going to go to the website. You're going to go all the way to the center of the page and click that donate button. And then you're going to scroll down and you're going to decide, how do I want to give them money? Because you're going to want to give us money. Because you're going to be like, look, these are poor. This is a poor teenager and an engineer. You're going to want to. And what you're going to do is you're going to see two options. You can do a Patreon, which is a monthly reoccurring donation. They typically collect the first few days of a month. You can do as little as $1. Or you can send us just some cash on Patreon, PayPal. And if you can't do anything, you know what? That's totally okay because I understand.
Just listen to us rant and rabble for hours on end, or give us a review. Like, I don't think we have any reviews. Or
you know what you can do that would actually, if you don't want to give money and you don't want to give a review, that would be more valuable than any of these things. Tell 10 of your friends.
Yeah, that is
10 of your friends.
That is
the only way we can spread the word.
That is true. Lots of people will say, I would love to be able to send you some money, but I just don't have it. And my response is always, more valuable than your money is your word of mouth.
Yes.
Yep. And you know why?
Sign up for the giveaway.
And you know why hams don't do that? It's because they're afraid that that their friends will look at the show and then look at them and say, you like that?
You watch that Gary guy? That chicken fries dude?
Somebody on one of the QRZ things was responding to one of those shows. He said,
I can't wait to get hate mail.
I've got hate.
You see, Gary's got really good topics, but man, I can't stand his talk show style.
All I want is somebody to call.
That's true. Yeah. You are a live call-in show.
I'll call you more.
It's a live show. I need somebody to call. I used to call.
I called a lot.
812-NET-HAM-1. Call.
Yep. Neal, do you want this? Can you stick in pre-produced shows? I guess you can. You want this one?
Oh, I'll just reflect off of yours.
Okay.
I posted it.
All right.
All right.
My yours.
My apologies, everyone. My kids say I need to go feed them.
Yeah, my sister's screaming in the background there. All right. Probably just heard.
So let me do my fundraising real quick. Ham Radio Now part is brought to you by you. Arvin is sitting back there. The East Coast Arvin and the West Coast Arvin.
There's a West Coast Arvin?
Can you see him there?
Yeah, see, it's right there. Yeah.
My kids call me the pig.
Yep. So Arvin East and Arvin West, hamradionow.tv if you enjoy the program. And now, this may be difficult with the pictures frozen. Let's see what we can do. We got too many people here, David.
Let's go through Marty Sterling.
YMCA style. We could do OV.
Each podcast.
Everybody,
Sterling and I are over.
I'll sign and we'll do it all together, right. All five of us.
Right. No, let's do it by podcast.
Okay.
So Sterling and I are over. Neil is, and the two of you are out.
That'll work.
Okay, hit it.
Well, do we want to do the I'm okay. Oh. I'm Marty, KC1CWF.
And I'm Sterling in 0SSC, and we are over.
You guys do give your names too.
Yeah, go ahead, Neal.
Oh, Neal. And I'm Neal Rapp, WB9VPG from HamTalkLive.
And I'm David Goldenberg, Whiskey 0 Delta Hotel Golf.
And I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Over.
And
out.
That 7-3
almost worked.
73.
Okay.
That was too good.